or wisdom for preservation. It is made clear through Scripture that the way of wisdom is the way of life. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and in verse 12, it said, for wisdom is a defense, and money is a defense. But the excellency of wisdom is that it giveth life to them that have it. It giveth life. Wisdom gives life to those who possess it. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 14. Proverbs 13, 14. The Bible said, the law of the wise is a fountain of life to depart from the snares of death. So wisdom causes man to connect the fountain of life and makes us to depart from the snares of death. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 24. He said, the way of life is above to the wise. That is, the man who is wise will easily, neatly, and cheaply connect with the way of life. That will make him to depart from the hell that is beneath. Will make him to depart from hell that is beneath. So the way of wisdom is the way of life. On the contrary, the way of foolishness is the way of death. That is, it is possible for people to die before their time because of foolishness. We saw that many times in Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and in verse 17, where he said, be not overmuch wicked, neither be thou foolish. Why should you die before your time? When a man is excessively wicked and excessively foolish, it can occasion premature death. In Proverbs 10:21, very pungent scripture, the lips of the righteous feed many, but fools die for want of wisdom. Fools die for want of wisdom. Fools die for want of wisdom. Nobody here shall die a fool's death. Fools die for want of wisdom. Proverbs chapter 9 and in verse 6, it says, forsake the foolish and live. You want to live? Forsake everything foolish, including the fool himself. Forsake everything that is foolish and you will live. So you can go in the way of understanding. Somebody say amen. The truth is, not every cause of death was due to the wickedness of the devil. There are some causes of premature death due to the strength of foolishness. Now, preservation of life does not only answer to prayer and fasting. You fasted very well, and you prayed very well, but you are foolish also very well. It is plus one minus one equals zero. The fasting and the prayer will produce no result. Produce no result. So there are wisdom keys and divine wisdom secrets in scripture that will cause the preservation of life and destiny to be facilitated. I have many of them tonight, and I'm going to trust the Lord to be able to see how I can race with time to touch them. Divine wisdom keys for preservation. Number one, dwell in the secret place of the Most High. Dwell in the secret place of the Most High. Psalm 91 verse 1. He said, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Most High, of the Almighty. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Psalm 23 and in verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Dwell in the secret place of the Most High means maintain intimacy with God. Because the way of intimacy is the way of security. Intimacy with God. Maintaining that feelable, palpable, tangible presence of God. The presence of God is the secret of the preservation of life. For thou art with me. Thou art with me. I can fear nothing under heaven if I am sure that thou art with me. Dwell in the secret place of the Most High. Number two, possess preservation word. Possess preservation word. Possess word from this scripture that guarantee your preservation. Psalm 94 and Psalm 91 and in verse 4, he said, he shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shall thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and thy buckler. The truth is the word. Thy word is truth. John 17, 17, thy word is truth. The truth is your shield. Philippians chapter 2 and in verse 16 makes it clear that the word of God is the word of life. Holding forth the word of life. Holding forth the word of life. 1 John chapter 1 verse 1, the Bible said, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, of the word of life. The word of life. So, take note of the following. The first is that the word of God is a shield for life and for destiny. It's a defense. To be warded is to be shielded. Preservation word. Secondly, it's important to note that the word of God is life itself. You cannot possess life and destruction succeeds with your life. The word of God is life itself. Thirdly, the word of God is seed. Is seed that reproduces after its kind. Mark chapter 4 verse 14 talks about the seed of the word. The sower soweth the word. Luke chapter 8 verse 11, it says, the seed is the word of God. So when you sow preservation word, such as he suffered no man to do me wrong, he rebuked kings for my sake, saying, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. When that word is sown in the soil of my heart, I chewed it, I meditated on it, it took hold on me. Then it will produce the result of what I read. Kings will be rebuked for my sake. And then he suffered. If you want to do me wrong, be ready to suffer. Hallelujah. This is very important. Don't just move about with an empty faith. Move about with a faith that is charged with word. Confirming to the devil and to everyone who know you that you are not one of those who will die before time. Somebody say amen. Possess preservation word. Number three, maintain faith and trust in God. We have a long journey tonight.
Maintain faith and trust in God.
The Psalm 91 verse 1 to 2, where we read, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In Him will I trust." Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 4 said, "The just shall live by his faith." The just shall live by his faith. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 16 said, "Taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked." Fire arrows from hell, you can stop it, stop them. What does it mean to you first? That faith is the life wire for the child of God. Faith is your life wire, just like the word. Second, that faith is a weapon of defense. It's a weapon of defense. And third, faith moves God into action to confirm what you believe Him for. Moves God into action. Faith is the life wire for the saint. Faith is your weapon of defense. And then faith moves God into action. Because without faith it's impossible to please God. Hebrews 11 and in verse 6. "For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him." That is the faith talking, the man's testimony. "I cannot die like chicken." That's faith talking. Out of the revelation of the word we saw in the second point, that revelation charges you up to a point where you say, "I can't die like chicken. I can't be wasted like that. Where blood is flowing, mine can't flow like that. If it will crash, I can't enter. And if I have entered, it cannot crash." Am I communicating? Maintain faith and trust in God. Number four, value divine guidance and direction. Value divine guidance and direction. Romans chapter 8 and in verse 14 said, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. So the Spirit of God leads God's children. Psalm 23 verse 1 to 4. Psalm 23 verse 1 to 4. He said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters," not beside troubled waters. "And as he's leading me, he restoreth my soul." So if I want to stray into disaster, since he is leading me, he pulls me back. Am I communicating? "He restoreth my soul. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the ways of righteousness," in the correct ways for my life. Place it on the screen. I'm still reading. "In the path of righteousness for his name's sake." So because he's leading me, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, "I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff. They comfort me." Somebody say a loud amen. Take note of this. First, that the absence of direction is the presence of disaster. If God is not leading me, then the waters will be troubled. If God is not leading me, he can't restore my soul. If I am missing road, there is no voice and nobody to tell me, come back. The second says, the absence of direction is the abundance of destruction. There are those who went on journeys they were not meant to go. There were those who entered relationships they were not meant to enter. In Proverbs chapter 22 and in verse 3. Proverbs 22 and in verse 3. A prudent man, call it the guided man, the wise man who is guided, he foreseeth the evil and hideth himself. But the ignorant, the simple, the one who doesn't take anything serious, who is not guided,
he passes on. He just is moving on, and they are punished. He suffers consequences because he cannot foresee what is ahead. Am I communicating? You remember the story of the young man whose employee organized killers for him, and they took him to the bush and cut him, and his intestines were out. I'm sure you remember that testimony. He said while he was going on that journey, the Spirit of the Lord kept telling him, is it every business you must do? Must you agree to do everything? Is it everywhere they call you to, you go? But he was already on the way. Hear this. It doesn't matter how far you went in the wrong direction. A U-turn is possible. Whenever you discover. It doesn't matter how far you have gone on the journey. God's servant Papa Yereko said they were on a journey some years back with his bosom friend at that time, Bishop Francis Wale Oke. And they were traveling. And then he felt in his spirit that he should not go on that journey. But he didn't know how to tell his friend because they already agreed to go. He went. The voice of the Lord said, don't move on this journey. He kept going until he heard an audible voice. If you move an inch from here, you are gone. So he matched the brake, bam, and did a U-turn. And he told his friend, the Lord doesn't want us to travel on this journey. And the friend said, I knew it too. Both of them, nobody. Everybody was. I don't know what it was. He felt maybe if I say we shouldn't go, it's because the car is my car and I'm the one driving. And so on. He said that would be how two of them would have died for nothing. For going on a road, on a journey that God did not command. There's nothing that is compulsory in this life except to make heaven. No business appointment is too compulsory. Oh, the wedding is already fixed. The marriage will continue after you have died. But you shall not die before your time. Do you understand what I'm saying? The people you are so concerned about that you are forcing yourself to do things you are not meant to do, they will continue with their life after you are no more here. Am I communicating at all? Anything you do that causes you to lose your peace, do a U-turn. Don't be too sentimental about life. Don't live life to sentiments. Live life to principles. Somebody say loud amen. So, dwell in the secret place of the Most High. Number two, possess preservation word. Number three, maintain faith and trust in God. Number four, value divine guidance and direction. Number five, avoid the wrong company. Avoid the wrong company. Proverbs chapter 13 verse 20. He that walketh with the wise, with wise men shall be wise. But a companion of fools shall be destroyed. Psalm 1 verse 1 to 4. He blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted, so he is alive, by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. But the ungodly are not so. The man who walketh in the counsel of the ungodly, who stands in the way of sinners, who sits in the seat of the scornful, everybody surrounding him are not correct. His life is not so. He says he is like the chaff that is driven away by the wind. It does not have stability, security, establishment in life. Anything can blow him away anytime.
Listen to me, beloved brothers and sisters. Many people have died other people's deaths. Did you hear what I just said? See how Jonah was inside the ship and everybody in the ship almost sank until they threw Jonah out. There are many who died other people's deaths in accidents, died other people's deaths in parties and all those kind of things. They went where they were not meant to be. One of the striking examples to me was the example of the relationship between King Jehoshaphat of Judah and King Ahab of Israel. There was a war between the Syrians and the Israelites. And the king of Judah, the king of Israel, Ahab, asked King Jehoshaphat to join him in the war. And you will not believe what Ahab told Jehoshaphat that he agreed. 2 Chronicles chapter 18 verse 29. And the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, I will disguise myself and will go to the battle so that the enemy looking for me to kill won't see me. But you put on your kingly robes. Come to the war as the king. I will not wear my kingly clothes. So the king of Israel disguised himself. The battle was not Jehoshaphat's battle. You know, the kind of thing that people agree to is amazing. The battle was Ahab's battle. But he told this man who is having affinity with Ahab, which is another major matter. One of the best kings in Israel was King Jehoshaphat. One of the worst kings in Israel was King Ahab. That was his friend for this moment. Don't wear your kingly. Don't wear your kingly cloth. Let me disguise. Now, go ahead and see what happened. No, go back up a bit. So, the king of Israel disguised himself. That's Ahab. And they went to battle. See the instruction. Now, the king of Assyria commanded the captains, the commanders of the battalions and so on, the chariots that were with him, saying, don't fight with anybody small or great. Only look for the king. Don't touch anybody. Only hit the man that is the king. Now the king that they are looking for has disguised himself. The one whose fight it was not is wearing kingly cloth. Move on. And it came to pass when the captains of the chariots saw Jehoshaphat, who came with his kingly, they said, it is the king of Israel. Therefore, they compassed him about to fight. But Jehoshaphat cried out, and the Lord helped him. And God moved them to depart from him. This is called divine intervention. For it came to pass that when the captains of the chariots perceived that he was not the king of Israel, they turned back from pursuing him. This man is wearing the kingly cloth, but he's not the king we are looking for. But how many of you know that if not for God, he would have been wasted? I mean, if not for God, they would have wasted him before they would have wasted him. Even if you are not the king we are looking for, what brought you here? What brought you here? What brought you here? That is what the devil did to many people. I am not looking for you, but what are you doing here? What brought you to this occasion? What brought you to this barrier? What brought you? What brought you to this funeral? When is it written that when people, somebody died, thou must be there? And I don't want to sound unnecessarily hard. I was meant to travel for a program. Something like that. Everything was already said. Somebody has even volunteered to give us a plane to go. Everything was set at the nick of time. It's like 1 hour to go to the airport. I felt the leading of the Spirit, don't move. Some people who are to go with me have already gone ahead. It's okay, I'm not moving. Told my wife, I'm not moving and this journey is canceled. She said, thank you, sir. The outcome of that event was not good. It wasn't good. It wouldn't be palatable. Am I communicating? You will not die anybody's death. Don't ever love anybody enough to disobey the leading of the Holy Spirit to you. Don't ever love anybody enough, fear anybody enough, respect anybody enough to disobey the leading of the Holy Spirit to you, because it will only be at your detriment. As I'm talking now, does that occur to you? Does anything occur to you? Does something occur to you? You remember the king of the young prophet? The young prophet that came from Bethel, that came to prophesy in Samaria, that God spoke to him and said, as you go to Samaria, go and prophesy against that altar that Jeroboam is worshiping. And he prophesied and the altar tore into two. And King Jeroboam wanted to slap him and his hand suspended in the air. And he prayed until Jeroboam's hand came down. And the man, an old prophet in Bethel, heard of the exploit of this young prophet. And every young prophet should be careful of old prophets. An old prophet is not old by age. He's old by expiration of prophetic experience. Are you following me? He's old by being alive and no more relevant. And this old prophet heard that this young prophet came and mighty manifestations. And he became jealous on the spot. How can I be on the ground here? And God sent somebody from another town to come and perform a miracle like this. And he sent for the young prophet. He said, come, visit my house. I have prepared a dinner. I want us to eat together. The young prophet said, God told me that when I come here and I prophesy, I should not branch anywhere. I should just return the way I came. I think I'm speaking from 2 Kings chapter 13. And this, or 1 Kings chapter 13. Yes. And this, yes, that's all the way down. Now, he said, God said I shouldn't branch anywhere. You will not believe what the old prophet said. The old prophet said, an angel of the Lord told me that I should ask you to turn back. My greatest question is, what God told me directly versus what somebody said that angel told him. I can't understand. It was God who spoke to me directly. You are telling me that angel told you. It is not even, I'm not even saying God told me. And then an angel came and said something else. It's God who told me. Now, if it was God told me and then an angel said, God said this, then maybe you can say, what a confusion. But this is a human being who is saying that God, what is the step? God told the angel. Angel told the old prophet. The old prophet is telling you. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, God told you directly. And you discarded what God told you in favor of what a man claims an angel told him. Supposing he didn't hear well. Supposing he heard the devil. He threw it away. Maybe to respect the man. And he started eating with him. As soon as the first bite was in his mouth, the same terrible prophet now opened his mouth and said, thus says the Lord.
You have disobeyed me. Therefore, as you are going now, a lion will kill you. So it is possible to miss God and still be prophesying. That was how this young man died for nothing. Aligning with the wrong person. Hearing the voice of the wrong person. And discarding what God told him. That was why I said, never respect anybody enough. Never love anybody enough. Respect anybody enough. Fear anybody enough. To disobey the leading of the Holy Ghost to you. Because it will be at your detriment, not his.
The old prophet prophesied. He said a lion will kill him. And truly, as the young prophet was going, a lion met him and killed him and left his donkey. The lion stood. The young prophet laid on the floor dead. His animal was standing. Lion didn't eat the animal. He didn't eat the dead body. Then the old prophet came and carried the young prophet's body to go and bury him. No wicked man will bury you. You know what he said? Let's go and bury the man. Because he is a man of God. And everything he said will come to pass. Aye. Let's carry him. Let's bury him. Because he's genuinely a man of God. And everything he said will come to pass. You won't die anybody's death.
Negative and wrong association will not kill you before your time. If you are saying amen, say a louder amen. If you are saying amen, say a louder amen. If you are saying amen, shout the loudest amen.
Take your seat in the presence of the Lord. I was racing to finish. But since we are in a very high, serious insecurity situation in our land, I will take my time not to rush this thing. So, avoid the wrong company means, first, anyone whose life you are not sure of. Give each other space. You are not sure of his life. Anyone whose ways you are not sure of. Reduce interaction. His ways you are not sure of. Thirdly, be careful with anyone whose principles are opposite yours. Your principles of life are not the same. I've said three things. Anyone whose life you are not sure of, then anyone whose ways you are not sure of, and then anyone whose principles are different from yours. And then fourthly, be careful with anyone who brings you face to face with danger. Either by their action or by their words, you are always encountering danger because of them. This is wisdom for preservation. Avoid the wrong company. That was our point number 5. Anyone whose life you are not sure of, be careful. With anyone whose ways you are not sure of, be careful. With anyone whose principles are different from yours, be careful. With anyone who brings you face to face with danger on a repeated basis. Last time you traveled with him, you almost died. And then you are traveling again and again and again. Number 6. Wisdom key for preservation. Completely shun
Fear. Job chapter 3 and in verse 25 all the way to verse 26. Job chapter 3 verse 25 all the way to verse 26 said, "For the thing which I greatly feared is come upon me. And that which I was afraid of is come unto me. I was not in safety, neither had I rest, neither was I quiet, yet trouble came." He should have said, "Then trouble came." Because all the things that he did were the things that should make trouble to come. What is fear? Someone defined fear as false evidence appearing real. F for false, E for evidence, A for appearing, and the R for real. I want to say it is false expectation attracted in reality. Fear is a state of negative anticipation, negative expectation, where the mind is overwhelmed with the idea that something may go wrong anytime. And listen to the following. First, you attract what you expect. You attract what you expect. And you precipitate what you anticipate. Fear is a magnet. What people expect, they don't run, they are unable to run from it. You expect, you attract what you expect. You precipitate what you anticipate. Second thing to note is that fear is faith in reverse. You know how you drive a car forward? That is how faith is. Reverse gear is how fear is. Driving forward and driving backward, which is safer? The reverse, that is how fear is. It is faith in reverse. It is faith in the devil. It is faith that what the devil planned to do, he will succeed. It is faith in the wickedness of the devil more than in the faithfulness of God. But that devil is a liar. Today I take authority over every trace of fear, and I announce to somebody, what the devil say he will do to you will never come to pass. Whether the fear came as a result of previous experiences, or the experiences of friends and loved ones you know, or came as a result of a dream of the night, I prophesy today, what the devil said he will do to you will never happen. It will never come to pass. Shout the loudest amen. Shout the loudest amen. Look at your neighbor and say, it will never come to pass. The third thing I want you to note is that fear is a sinker. A sinker of life and destiny. Fear sinks people. Peter was walking on the water. In Matthew chapter 14 and in verse 30 to 31, he was walking on the water. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And from the fear, he began to sink. He was afraid and beginning to sink. Fear is a sinker of life and destiny because it's a companion of doubt and unbelief. He began to fear, and Jesus asked him, "Why did you fear? Why did you doubt? Why did you, oh you of little faith, why did you doubt? You will not sink." There is an easy way to know what the devil wants to do in your life, and that is by knowing the thing he has made you to start fearing.
Whatever the devil wants you to start fearing is what he's planning to do. The fear gives him the license for operation. Just like faith gives God license to operate. And so you deal with the fear brutally. Deal with it with word. Deal with it with declarations. Deal with it with prayer. And it goes. Every spirit of fear here is cursed to its roots. Number 7. Avoid wrong and negative words. Wisdom key number 7. Avoid wrong and negative words. Because the Bible said in Proverbs 18 and in verse 21, it said, death and life are in the power of the tongue. They are in the power of the tongue. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. You know how the Living Bible puts it? The man who... 21. Those who love to talk will suffer the consequences. Men have died for saying the wrong thing. Wrong words are killer words. Numbers chapter 14 verse 28. God said, as you have spoken in my ears, so will I do unto you. Tell them. Say unto them, as truly as I live, saith the Lord, as you have spoken in my ears, so will I do to you. Somebody say a loud amen. Somebody say a loud amen. Somebody say the loud most amen. Take a note of the following and then maybe I'll round off with here. First, words carry the power of life and death, blessing and curses. Words carry the power of life and death, blessing and curses. They have that power. Your words, how you speak, can make you live, and how you speak can cut short your life. I heard the stories of people sick in the hospital, is healed, well, discharged to go home. Say, I'm tired. What's all this life about? Just slept, never woke up. Second, what you say determines what you see. God said, let there be light. And there was light, and God saw that the light was good. God said, and God saw. God said, and God saw. When he said the earth should bring forth vegetation, and the earth brought forth, and God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the first day, and the evening and the morning were the second day. God was saying, and God was seeing. What you say determines what you see. Thirdly, speaking is sowing, and sowing is reaping. Speaking is sowing, and sowing is reaping. The sower soweth the word. Speaking is sowing. And sowing is reaping. How many of you have been annoyed by words that people spoke to you? Oh yeah, very hurtful words. So they entered into your heart like seed. And the same venom with which they spoke reproduced into a harvest of bitterness. Am I communicating? An experiment was done sometime. I got this information from Zig Ziglar. And he talked about how they were milking cattle, and some cattle brought forth bitter, scanty, and sour milk. And those were the ones that were manhandled, they were beaten, they were spoken, you useless cow, and they were just hitting them and talking rubbish to them and all that. And the cow that was not literally hearing word but perceived the emotion of the words couldn't produce much milk.
And whatever they produced was bitter and sour and scanty. And they were so lovely, lovely. And they were just talking. The milk flowed abundantly and sweet. Speaking is sowing, and sowing is reaping. I am here for a very long time. The devil that can take me out does not exist. Speaking is sowing, and sowing is reaping. No man who has breath in his nostril can take my own. You want to kill? Kill yourself. You want death? Die. He said that, and I'm talking after the other of my master Jesus. He said, as my father sent me, I sent you. And when the father sent me him, he said, no man taketh my life from me. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. You shall fulfill your days. Is there somebody who wants to speak some words about your life, about yourself, about your destiny? Stand up on your feet and speak some positivistic, enthusiastic, optimistic words. I am fulfilling my days. I shall serve the Lord. I am serving the Lord my God. He blesses my bread and my water. He takes away sickness from the midst of me. I cannot cast my young. I cannot be barren. The number of my days, Jesus, Almighty God, shall fulfill. Open your mouth and speak to God. In the name of Jesus. Exodus chapter 23 and in verse 25. And you shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless your bread and your water. And I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. There shall nothing cast their young nor be barren in thy land. The number of your days I will fulfill. Say after me, say, Father, as I serve you, I thank you. Because you are blessing my bread and my water. Father, I demand that you take away Every trace of sickness from the midst of me. Every trace of sickness from the center of my life. In the name of Jesus, I demand and decree that I cannot cast my young. I cannot be barren. I cannot be fruitless. And the number of my days, you are fulfilling. Father, I demand the fulfillment of the number of my days. Oh Lord, in the name of Jesus. Say again, say, Father, I am serving you. I am serving you. And you are blessing my bread and my water. I demand that you take away every sickness from the midst of my life. I cannot cast my young. I cannot be fruitless. I demand for the fulfillment of the number of my days. Now, in the name of Jesus, open your mouth and pray. Pray. I demand for the fulfillment of the number of my days. The fulfillment of the number of my days. The fulfillment of the number of my days. Leperede gaya da gaga da la la. Let us separate gaga da da da. In Jesus' precious name. Prayer number 2. Isaiah chapter 54 and in verse 17. Please, I want you to pray with energy and with fire. Everybody read it out one too loud. No weapon that is fashioned against thee shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Now, this is how to read it now. We're going to read it again. No weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that rises against me in judgment, I condemn now. This is my heritage as a servant of the Lord, and my righteousness is of him, saith the Lord. Is that easy? Want to read? No weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise up against me in judgment, I condemn. This is my heritage as the servant of the Lord, and my righteousness is of him, saith the Lord. Say it again. No weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise against me in judgment, I condemn. This is my heritage as a servant of the Lord, and my righteousness is of the Lord, saith the Lord. Say after me, say, Father,
Father,
fulfill
this scripture
in my life today, as I demand
that every
satanic and human conspiracy against my life, against my destiny, every conspiracy of witches, of wizards, of the occult, every conspiracy of wicked, bitter, jealous human beings against my life and destiny, today I command and demand that they scatter in the name of Jesus, that they scatter by fire now. Open your mouth and pray. Scatter every conspiracy from the pit of hell, every conspiracy from the pit of hell.
Precious name. Proverbs chapter 26 and in verse 27. Everybody read it together, loud and clear. Whoso diggeth a pit shall fall therein, and he that rolleth a stone, it will return upon them. Again, say it loud again. Say, whoso diggeth a pit shall fall therein, and he that rolleth a stone, it will return upon him. Say after me, every digger,
every
pit digger,
against
my life and destiny, inherit
your pit.
Shiba gadaga lagaya da 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 da. Say after me, say every pit digger against my life and destiny, I command you. In the name of Jesus,
inherit
your pit now. Again, every pit digger
against
my life and my destiny, I command you, in the name of Jesus,
inherit,
occupy
your pit
now. Open your mouth and pray. Every pit digger
against
my life, against my destiny, inherit your pit. Occupy your pit. Inherit 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 your pit. Every pit digger against my life and my destiny, I command you, in the name of Jesus, inherit your pit now. Inherit your pit. 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 Now, shabagadagalagada. Le paradela. In Jesus' precious name, there is a second part to that verse. And he that rolleth a stone, it will return upon him. It is called back to sender. Say, every evil stone,
or
weapon
of the enemy
looking for me, back to sender. Say, in the name of Jesus,
every evil stone
or weapon of the enemy and their agents looking for me, in the name of Jesus. Listen, this is the time when what they wish for you happens to them. If they wish you mad, it returns back. In one of our healing and deliverance services, it was in area one, a young lady was healed of madness. And the same hour, stepmother in the village that sent her the madness received it on the spot.
Lift your hands, say, in the name of Jesus.
Every evil stone
or weapon
of the enemy
and their agents
looking for me,
in the name of Jesus,
back to sender.
Open your mouth and pray.
Every evil stone
of the enemy.
Back to center. Back to center.
Every evil stone or weapon of the enemy and their agents looking for me, in the name of Jesus, back to sender. Back to sender. Back to sender. Back to sender. Back to sender.
In Jesus' precious name. One more before the final. Acts chapter 12, verse 23 and 24. Read it together, everybody. And immediately, the angel of the Lord smote him because he gave not
God the glory. And he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost.
But the word of God grew. Read it again. Read it again from verse 23. Talking about Herod's death. One to go. And immediately, the angel of the Lord smote him because he gave not God the glory. And he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. But the word of God grew and multiplied.
There are people, for as long as they are alive, you won't see growth and you won't see rest.
When Herod died, the word of God grew. The ministry grew. The assignment grew.
Anybody like that, wherever they are,
their number one option is to repent. But if they fail to repent, they shall be laid to rest. Lift your hands. Say, in the name of Jesus, every agent of the enemy standing in the way of the growth and rest of my life and my destiny,
in the name of Jesus,
I command you,
we command you,
be laid to rest
now.
Open your mouth and pray.
Every agent,
unrepentant
agent
of the enemy,
every unrepentant agent
of the enemy,
every unrepentant agent
of the enemy,
standing in the way
of my growth
and in the way
of rest
for my life
and my destiny,
we command you,
be laid to rest now.
Reta saca le de bagabaganda.
Rato saca la le de bagabaganda.
Rato soto la bagabaganda.
Rekata saca la bagabaganda.
Rako to saca la bagabaganda.
Rata saca la bagabaganda.
Shato la bagabaganda.
Rata saca la bagabaganda.
Zado la bagabaganda.
Reta saca la bagabaganda.
Garo da la la.
Reta sepe de bagabaganda.
Every agent of the enemy standing in the way of my growth and of my rest in life and in destiny, I command you, in the name of Jesus, be laid to rest now. 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 In Jesus' precious name.
Finally, Luke chapter 10, verse 19. I give unto you power to tread on serpents and on scorpions and over every power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. Father, we take authority over the power of the enemy in Nigeria. Every altar of kidnapping, altar of banditry, altar of terrorism, altar of ritual killing, catch fire. Every altar and their high priests and their sponsors and their hitmen, catch fire.
Lift your voice and say, Father,
Father,
we take authority over every altar of evil, altars of wickedness in Nigeria, altars of kidnapping, of banditry, of terrorism, of ritual killing, altars of wickedness. They are sponsors. They are high priests. They are evil priests. Altars of wickedness. They are hitmen. Today, we command you, in the name of Jesus, catch fire. Catch fire. Open your mouth and pray. Catch fire. Altars of wickedness. Altars of banditry. Altars of terrorism. Catch fire. Leto kezida galabaya dada. Catch fire. Catch fire. Catch fire. Catch fire. Catch fire. Catch fire. Igala bada 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 dada. Rada bada bada gaga 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 Rato satale de gaba 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 Reta satala gaba 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 Sala gaba 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 Le pere de gaba 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 Le pere de gaba 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 Sala de gaba 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 Reta se pere de gaba 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 Le pere de gaba 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 Zora de gaba 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 Zera ta satela la gaba 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 Shasha. We take authority over every altar of evil, altar of wickedness, altars of killing, altars of banditry, altars of kidnapping, altars of wickedness, and their hitmen, and their high priests, and their sponsors. Catch fire! Catch fire! Fire. In Jesus' precious name. The Lord has answered us. Can we give the Lord a big clap and a shout of praise?
Hallelujah.
How many feel the fire? You feel the fire. You feel something has happened. We're going to take 5 minutes of aggressive, explosive, intensive, extensive, explorative praise tonight. Hey! And I want you to praise like somebody from another world. I want you to praise like finally, that devil that wouldn't let you rest is laid to rest. I want you to pray like somebody who is here for a long run. You are not living here at all in a hurry. Give the Lord a shout of praise. Let's run with praise.
Show.